Lord, we ask for your presence in this house this morning as we worship in your word. Lord, enrich our hearts and minds for Jesus' sake this morning as we worship you. Lord, keep us ever so close to you in our hearts and minds. Lord, that we walk in the Spirit, we don't fulfill the lusts of the flesh, but God, that we just grow closer and closer to you with every waking moment. And every time we dig into your word, every time we meet you in prayer, Father, we just want to be close to you. We ask this and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. We have our newsletter out. It's not in the bulletin. If you didn't get one, please, you can have this one if there's someone out there that didn't get one. And I just wanted to read it real briefly. He said to them, the harvest truly is great, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into the harvest. That's from Luke 10:2. In God's kingdom project, we as believers in Christ are called into the harvest field. God has given us his Holy Spirit and sent us on mission for his great purpose. In Luke 15, Jesus tells the three parables. We've went over them briefly in the message portion of our worship recently. And they allow us to see his great shepherd heart. So please be in prayer on how God is leading you to participate in his kingdom project with the gift and talents that he's graced you with. We as many members form one body, his body that goes into the harvest field. We are his workers. I had to wrestle with that quite a bit on what the Lord was calling me personally to do. But we all have that, and we're all called to get with God and understand where he's placed us and how he's gifted us and what he wants us to do. If you have your Bibles this morning, turn with me to the book of Jonah. Right after Obadiah and right before Micah. For my thin line, it is really hard to find. You'll breeze right over it. The pages are so thin and the print's so small. If you flip two pages, you miss a book. The book of Jonah, we're going to look at specifically chapter 4 this morning. And I want to echo Carol's question. Is do we hold to the truth that the God of the day is also the God of the night? In the good times and in the bad times. There's a question that we as believers face in our world today that asks a very similar question. And today I'm going to pray that God equips our hearts and minds as I attempt to give you one answer and one possible way to answer this question. Is the God of the New Testament the same God of the Old Testament? And we say that and we know that because we use this particular complicated science called reading, and we know and we understand. But I want to take you this morning on a little journey of how you can better answer that question when we see skeptics, to fortify our hearts as believers in Christ as we dig into the Lord's word in the Old Testament. Is the God of the New Testament the same God in the Old Testament? Absolutely. God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He has not changed. Jonah, in the historicity of the book, is one of, scholars believe, the oldest books of the Bible. The oldest. And we all know some of the stories. I'm just going to brief it, the first few chapters. We know in chapter 1, God calls Jonah to go to Nineveh and preach. He says, arise and go to Nineveh. So one of the things you will hear and see in themes in the New Testament and the Old Testament is judgment, mercy, and forgiveness. And people have this, I'm not sure what you would call it, their own interpretation and understanding without looking at the scriptures themselves to say that this God of the New Testament is somehow all-loving and all-caring, but it's not there in the Old Testament. He's a God of wrath. He's a God of judgment. And he is a God of judgment. And he is a God of justice. He is also a God of mercy. And it is the same God in the old as in the new. So God judged Nineveh's actions. There was wickedness that came up before the Lord from that great city, making a judgment, saying, that is wrong. It's evil. It's just sheer wickedness. So God's judgment is present in chapter 1. And then chapter 1 and chapter 2, we see immediately Jonah running from God's call. And we all know the fish story. Jonah was in the belly of a fish for 3 days, which also our Lord, a couple times in the Gospel of Matthew, said that an evil and wicked, adulterous generation sought a sign, and they said the only one that would be given to him was the sign of Jonah. 3 days, 3 nights. But we know the story that Jonah ran, and he ran. And a lot of times when we read Jonah, we read prodigal stories. We read of our tug of wars with God. And maybe somebody in here this morning is running from God, like Jonah. I'm going to pray that you stop running today, because our God is a great God of mercy and compassion. But Jonah ran, and as humans, we do fail. And Jonah did that. So he was swallowed up by a fish, and then the fish spits him out on dry land. I don't know how that happened. We could have an imagination and we could picture it. Was it like one of those pumpkin cannons and just and splat on the sand? I'm not sure. But we laugh because we're created in the image of God. So I believe God has a sense of humor. So where it's silent, we can use imagination and just meditate on the Lord's word. Not read into it, but meditate and contemplate his word. Jonah turned and went the other way because he wanted Nineveh obliterated. He wanted Nineveh gone. As an Israelite, he couldn't stand Nineveh. So he went the other way. And we'll read about this in a little bit. In chapter 3, Jonah again, God tells him, again, go to Nineveh. And this time he does. And in chapter 3, we read of a great revival of that great city of Nineveh and the people there. Jonah obeyed this time, reluctantly, but he obeyed. And there was a great revival. And the people repented and they turned. I keep losing my place here this morning. I want to start this morning reading in chapter 3 and verse 10. Then God saw their works, that they turned from their evil way. And God relented from the disaster that he had said he would bring upon them. And he did not do it. But it displeased Jonah exceedingly, and he became angry. So he prayed to the Lord and said, Ah, Lord, was not this what I said when I was still in my country? Therefore I fled previously to Tarshish, for I know that you are a gracious and merciful God, slow to anger and abundant in loving kindness, one who relents from doing harm. Therefore now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live. Then the Lord said, Is it right for you to be angry? So Jonah went out of the city and sat on the east side of the city. There he made himself a shelter and sat under it in the shade, till he might see what would become of the city. And the Lord God prepared a plant and made it come up over Jonah, that it might be shade for his head and deliver him from his misery. So Jonah was very grateful for the plant. But as morning dawned the next day, God prepared a worm, and it so damaged the plant that it withered. And it happened when the sun arose, and God prepared a vehement east wind, and the sun beat on Jonah's head so that he grew faint. Then he wished for death for himself. and said, "It is better for me to die than to live." Then God said to Jonah, Is it right for you to be angry about the plant?" And he said, "It is right for me to be angry, even to death." But the Lord said, "You've had pity on the plant for which you have not labored, nor made it grow, which came up in the night and perished in a night. And should I not pity Nineveh, that great city, in which are more than 120,000 persons who cannot discern between their right hand and their left, and much livestock?" So Jonah couldn't stand Nineveh. And we see here that he was angry. That reminds us of a story, a New Testament story. We had the story of the prodigal son we recently went over, and the older brother who was angry at the rejoicing of the younger. Jonah here, wrapped up in himself, is furious. We read in chapter 3, verse 10, about the great repentance and revival that came to Nineveh, and Jonah's response in chapter 4, verse 1. But it displeased Jonah exceedingly, and he became angry. He became angry. Jonah knew God's character. He knew. He says in verse 2, "So he prayed to the Lord and said, 'Ah, Lord, was not this what I said when I was still in my country? Therefore I fled previously to Tarshish, for I know that you are a gracious and merciful God, slow to anger and abundant in loving kindness, one who relents from doing harm.'" So Jonah did his math. I know how merciful God is. I know how loving he is. He's calling me to go to this city that I can't stand. So if I run that way, God will take out that city. Well, he didn't win. We know that. But he was furious about the character of God. Furious that God would turn his ear and his eyes towards Nineveh in a compassionate and merciful way. Jonah wrestles with a lot of something that we wrestle with all the time. And we may not want to, we may know it, and I'll try to add a little bit of humor in here. But justice, according to God, is not revenge. It's not revenge. A lot of the times when we get wounded, when we get hurt, we want revenge. God is about justice. How many of us have seen good guys and bad guy movies? And you don't have to be ashamed, like James Bond or Clint Eastwood or John Wayne. Anybody seen any good guy, bad guy movies? Shame on you for watching those movies. Just playing. But good guy, bad guy movies. What happens when we see what the bad guy is doing in those movies? We really want to see him repent and join the good guy side. When that bad guy we view as being hurtful and harmful, we want to see what John Wayne, James Bond, we want to go see him take him out. And not only do we want to see him take him out, we want to see it happen badly. If we're honest with the flesh. Because God's ways are not our ways. We, most of the time, want revenge. Jonah wanted God to obliterate that city. God, in his justice, had other plans. True justice seeks to sift out the wicked and set someone on a right path, namely, a path of righteousness. During your study time, if you're taking notes this morning, there's a couple references in Isaiah 59 to justice in the Lord's heart towards a people where justice is not happening. It's a beautiful chapter. Remember Micah 6:8, and it's up on the overhead. "He has shown you, O man, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you but to do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with your God. God is not passive when it comes to seeing the wickedness of our condition, of our circumstances, of someone's circumstances, of Nineveh. God is not passive. There is no love without God's justice. A beautiful quote from an apologist I admire named Michael Ramsden. He says, "True love does not exist in the absence of judgment. True love only exists in the presence of it." God and his judgment and his justice seeks to put us on his path and draw us to himself. That great revival that happened in Nineveh, the people all the way up to the king put on sackcloth and sat in ashes. They called a fast. They turned. A moral judgment says that is wrong. If you see someone steal someone's cell phone or dent Rita's car in the parking lot and just drive away and not say nothing, a true moral judgment says that is wrong. That's wrong. There is a difference. Truth is not subjective to what we feel. There is a definite right. There is a definite wrong. Oh, forgive me. I have some serious sniffles this morning. Have to make more references to Rita's car. Maybe the laughter will be the medicine that bring it out. I want to read you a little story, and it's up on the overhead that has love and compassion and justice wrapped up in this story as well. And it's in 1 Kings 3, 24 to 27. Then the king said, and this is Solomon, there's a debate between two women who are staying in a place, and these young babies, and one happens to perish, and one still has a baby. So someone pulls a switch. Something's going on. They bring this situation to the king, because there was two women, two babies. Now there's two women, one baby, and both are fighting over the baby. So they bring him to the king. And the king said, Saul, I would not encourage this, but it's bold, and it gets to the point. He says, "Bring me a sword." So they brought a sword before the king. And the king said, "Divide the living child in two, and give half to one and half to the other." How's that for sorting out a situation? Then the woman whose son was living, this is the mom who knew it was her kid, spoke to the king, for she yearned with compassion for her son. And she said, "Oh my Lord, give her the living child, and by no means kill him." But the other said, "Let him be neither mine nor yours, but divide him." So the king answered and said, "Give the first woman the living child, and by no means kill him. She is his mother." The word compassion and merciful that shows up in our English language has a pretty good history. Compassion is more than a feeling. We can feel dismayed about something and not do anything. We can feel sympathy or empathy for someone and still be not moved. Compassion is a deep sense that forces us to move. This mother and her compassion, the Bible says, she yearned with compassion for her son. That deep thought That deep compassion led to her movement, and she spoke to stop the injustice that was getting ready to happen. I will not allow this child to be sawn in two. I'd rather give him up, because justice brings forth righteousness. It is a path of straightening out the feet that we walk with. I just had something pop in my head. Sorry, I can't even remember what it was. Make the crooked way straight. Justice. So the mother was moved with compassion. That Hebrew word rakum is used over and over in the Old Testament. And it's translated into our English, merciful and compassion. And Wikipedia's dictionary says, compassion is a deep awareness of the suffering of another, coupled with the wish to relieve it. Deep compassion forces you to move. You want to stop it. You want to correct it. So Solomon executes justice, and he gives the baby to the rightful mother. Justice is a good thing. Making wise judgments is also a good thing. God in his mercy and his compassion wanted Nineveh to turn from their wickedness. God in his justice, his judgment saw their wicked acts, and his justice and his compassion said, I'm going to send a preacher. God looks on the heart. We look on the outside. Jonah couldn't stand it. He was so upset, he would rather be dead. Again, this is a testimony of how displeased Jonah was. He says in verse 3, therefore now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live. I don't know where or why or how much Jonah hated or despised Nineveh. Maybe some of us, if we look across the landscape of our news and we see other countries we deal with politically and affairs that we get into militarily, maybe sometimes we adopt the same heart. We would rather see them vanquished like the bad guy in our movies, obliterated and wiped off the face of the planet. God in his judgment and his justice shows mercy, and he wanted them to turn from their wicked ways. And they did. And God is not done with Jonah. In his great compassion and justice, he endures through Jonah's temper tantrum. Jonah's throwing a fit here. He's throwing a temper tantrum. I have a couple little babies, and I'll tell you what, I know what it looks like when a 2-year-old throws a temper tantrum. You got grandbabies in here, you know what a temper tantrum looks like. They're throwing a fit. And Jonah is displeased here, and he's throwing a fit. I'm going to read verses 3 through 8 again. Therefore now, O Lord, please take my life, for it is better for me to die than to live. Then the Lord said, is it right for you to be angry? How many of us, if we've been mad at something unjustly, we feel the Lord tugging on our heart, saying, are you sure you want to be mad at this? Do you have a good right to be mad? We just know the Holy Spirit's work there when our stubbornness gets the best of us. So Jonah went out of the city, and he sat on the east side of the city. And there he made himself a shelter and sat under it in the shade till he might see what would become of the city. Maybe he's still contemplating things will go bad and he'll get his vanquishment that he's looking for. because he still has an attitude. And the Lord prepared a plant and made it come over Jonah that it might be shade for his head and deliver him from his misery. So Jonah was very grateful for the plant. Jonah is throwing a fit before God. A fit. And God provides him comfort. And Jonah appears to be grateful and somewhat repentant. And in verse 7 he says, "But as morning dawned, and the next day God prepared a worm, and it so damaged the plant that it withered. And it happened when the sun arose that God prepared a vehement east wind, and the sun beat on Jonah's head, so that he grew faint. Then he wished death for himself and said, 'It is better for me to die than to live.'" He is so upset. He almost, have any of us been so distraught? It literally makes us physically ill to our stomach. This is what Jonah is going through in his anger and in his hatred towards Nineveh. And his distaste and his displeasure with Almighty God, as God is still enduring with him through this. If we're talking today as the God of the Old Testament, the God of the New Testament, yes, he is. Jonah, even in his temper tantrum, God is staying right there with him and trying to reason with Jonah and teach him. Verses 9 and 10. "Then God said to Jonah, 'Is it right for you to be angry about the plant?' And he said, 'It is right for me to be angry, even to death.' But the Lord said, 'You've had pity on the plant for which you have not labored, nor made it grow, which came up in the night and perished in a night.'" Do any of us ever just want to stay angry? Where we're just, "No, Lord, I'm mad right now." And we know God is tugging on our hearts to bring it to him and to lay it at his feet. And we know God is asking us the same questions he's asking Jonah here. Why you gotta be mad? There's a lot to reflect on here. This is something definitely that we should think about and take note of when we get frustrated at things and we sense the Holy Spirit tugging on our heart. Jonah didn't make this plant grow. He didn't work for it. He didn't create it. And yet he had pity on the plant. And God points out that he had pity on the plant. Verse 11. God says, "And should I not pity Nineveh, that great city, in which are more than 120,000 persons who cannot discern between their right hand and their left, and much livestock?" Jonah cared for the plant, this little plant that brought him shade. And God tells him, "Shouldn't I pity Nineveh, that great city?" And there's probably a reason that there's 120,000 persons noted here. My Bible, specifically in the New King James, says 120,000 persons, people, God wanted to turn. Does that sound like the New Testament? God used the disobedient prophet here in Jonah to draw all kinds of people to himself, even on his path of disobedience. The people he was on the boat with. I'm not a sailor. Has anybody ever sailed, carried cargo on a ship? Is it when things start to get rough? Do people really want to just start throwing things overboard? We gotta lighten the load. But nonetheless, in the story of Jonah, we see the people on the boat even turning their eyes towards God. We see Nineveh turning their eyes towards God. And we see the closing verse of the book of Jonah. And God said, should I not pity Nineveh, that town which you hate? Sounds to me like the same compassionate, merciful, and loving God in the New Testament. John 3:16 is up on the overhead. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. God looked on the condition of humanity, looked on the condition of his creation, and he provided the solution. Never is God passive in the Old Testament or New about calling sin, sin, and judging sin as wrong and lawless. But the same God in the Old Testament is the same God in the New Testament. As in the New Testament, we read he's provided an eternal solution in Christ Jesus. Paul says in Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. The message of the cross is mercy. He condemns sin in the flesh. God is not passive in the New Testament. You as a child of God, talking to that person who doesn't see the Bible, who doesn't read it, that says, it seems like the God of the Old Testament is a God of wrath and judgment. And it seems there's something different going on in the New Testament. He is one and the same, and he has not changed yesterday, today, and forever. The difference is the eternal life that's offered in Christ Jesus. The message of the cross is that God has judged sin and his justice has been satisfied. Peter writes in 1 Peter 3:18, for Christ also suffered once for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive by the Spirit. I'm saying it over and over this morning. The same God you read of in the Old Testament is the same God in the New. Paul said in 2 Corinthians, all this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. We get to carry to a world a message that Jonah carried, but even more glorious. God's justice and his mercy has always been there. Always been there. And like Jonah, we, as God's laborers in his kingdom effort, can take that message to the Ninevehs. Because we know God wants them to repent. If you're taking notes this morning, take note of 2 Corinthians 5:18 and 19 here. That God is in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not counting their sins against them. Jonah made a big mistake because he knew the great compassion, the great mercy, the great loving kindness that is wrapped up in the character of the Creator of everything. And he wanted to take that message and run the other way with it so he could see Nineveh fail. God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself, not counting their sins against them. When we say God so loved the world, we mean God so loved and had so much compassion that he acted. He stepped out of heaven to provide you and me with the forgiveness and eternal life that's offered in Christ Jesus. Jesus shows us the Father. He shows us love. He shows us mercy. As I ask our men to come forward this morning, as we take communion, meditate on the grace of God this morning. That God so loved, he gave. Because of Christ's work on the cross, his resurrection from the dead, the sign he gave to that generation, the 3 days and three nights, we have peace with Almighty God. Peace.